Good evening. I would like to start the Plan Commission. This is a regular meeting of June 15th. The meeting is called to order. Gail, may we please have a roll call?
Yes, Doyle?
Here.
Wilsick?
Here.
Lal?
Here.
Shears?
Here.
Trapinski?
Here. We have a quorum. Tonight, we will not have any minutes of meeting to approve, so that those meetings from last month are not ready, so that they will not come into play this evening. And as far as unfinished business goes, the Oak Brook Promenade, seeking a text amendment to zoning ordinance section 13-7A-2, the B1 district special use to add a special use to allow schools, private, non-boarding, accredited educational facilities, including those provided on a one-on-one or small group teaching and tutoring service. The petitioner has requested that for a continuance. He is seeking some additional information and has asked for this continuance, so they will not be petitioning again this evening. Before we start new business, I want to set up the procedure for the meeting tonight. First of all, there's flash flood warnings. I know a number of people here, probably myself included, have property in the floodplain. It is a major concern. I would like to limit the meeting tonight to 9:15. And at that time, we'll call the meeting adjourned, and if we need to continue the meeting further, then we will. Is there, how many people in the audience are planning to speak tonight?
I'm planning to speak for the people I see in the audience.
Okay, so right now we have four people, six people speaking.
And I have an expert that will be with me, Mr. Abel, so two of us will speak on this.
Okay, what we'll do is we'll have the petitioner speak, and then we'll open it up, you know, for your comments, and then for other members in the audience for comments. I'm asking, so that we meet our deadline for 9:15, that people be concise and to the point, and be not repetitive of something else that may have been said, so that we could hear tonight everyone who's here hear their comments. And after people have spoken, then we'll open up to the plan commissioners for some questions and answers. Okay, fair enough, everyone? Thank you. Okay, the new business tonight, what we have is a multi-owners, multi-parcel properties located on Canterbury Lane, Hunt Club Lane, and Oak Brook Road, that's 31st Street, requesting a map amendment to rezone the subject parcels from R1 to R2. I'm going to ask Bob to start with a brief overview, and then we'll hear from the petitioner. And when members of the audience come to make their comments, I just want to remind everyone, please state your name and address. Mr. Capetta has requested a variance. He's going to be speaking from his desk. Okay, Bob, can we?
Okay, 30 seconds. The map that's up on the screen, that map in bright yellow depicts the parcels that are part of this request. As Marcia indicated, it involves 9 property owners, 11 parcels, all seeking a map amendment from R1 to R2. R1 is a 2-acre minimum lot size. R2 is 1 acre. And I'll leave it at that.
Okay, and may we hear from the petitioner, please?
I get the remote now, so I guess it's powerful. My name is Art Zwemke. My address is 1351 Davy Drive in Batavia, Illinois. I work for the Robert Arthur Land Company. That is a company that's owned by Dr. Jafari, who is one of the petitioners tonight. Tonight we have, out of the 9 petitioners, we have 7 in attendance. I will make some opening comments, and then I've asked them to prepare in their own words what they've experienced with their property and why they want to have this rezoning from R1 into R2, okay? So the first thing I want to say is thanks to the staff. They've been very helpful here in steering us along to put this together. Ordinarily, when somebody comes in for a rezoning, it's one particular parcel, not multiple parcels. We thought that this was an efficient way of handling this as opposed to having 9 different petitions come in 9 different times. So hopefully you'll see the efficiency of this process. I'd like to just introduce the people in the audience, if I could, by name, so that you can see who's here. John and Patty Kiefer, raise your hand. Dr. Jafari. Let's see, Carol Stark, Alan Rocca, Ashe Thacker, and wife, okay, and Elizabeth Bafardi, okay. So these are 7 out of the 9 petitioners. A couple others weren't able to make it here tonight. We also have Nancy Carino, who is a broker with Berkshire Hathaway. That's available to comment as necessary here during the evening. A couple of things I want to mention here in this rezoning is that we're talking about 2 acres, and maybe to break this or pull this apart a little bit more, 2 acres of land is over 87,000 square feet, okay? If you were to build a 5,000 square foot house on 87,000 square feet, you'd have about a 2,500 square foot print, okay? Stacking them on top of one another, a 2-story 5,000 square foot house. So in today's existing zoning here, this zoning would take up only about 3% of the size of that lot. And if you're going to grant this, or the board ultimately grant this, that same house on a 1-acre house would be just less than 6% of the land. So I'm sure there'll be issues that'll be brought up about flooding and impervious surfaces and those kind of things. This is not taking up a big part of the land. These are not small lots, these are large lots. Also, we're not asking for R3. And if you take a look at the map around us, the yellow indicates the petitioners. The other large lots, both south of Oak Brook Road and north of Oak Brook Road, are all over 3 acres. Some are 3.5 and some are 3.8. Those sizes vary, depending upon the location of the lot. But you can see around the perimeter are other lots, and those, as you can see from the key below, especially up to the north, those are R3 lots, and your R3 zoning is a 25,000 square foot lot. That's the minimum size, okay? So again, if you put a 5,000 square foot house on a 25,000 square foot lot, that's a different scenario here. We'd be covering about 10% of that land mass. We're not talking about that. We're talking about R1 to R2. I've been doing this for quite some time. In fact, the consultant on the other side, Mr. Abel, is sort of an idol of mine because I used to sit and watch him do his work for many years because he's a pro at doing what he does. And I think he'd probably agree with me that what comes down to these zoning issues are usually about 4 different factors that are concerned. And they're hot buttons, but there are degrees of hot buttons. Depends upon everybody's circumstances. So I'd like to touch on those just briefly. First is, there'd be a concern about property values, okay? That's always in every one of the zoning cases I've been involved with, what's the impact on property values? The second one is about traffic and public safety. What's this gonna mean for me to get to work or back and forth to my home? The third, how appropriate for tonight, flooding. Okay, what's going to happen here if a home gets built next door to my home? Is my lot going to flood? And the fourth one, which usually comes up, but in this case it's more of a positive, I think, than a negative, has to do with schools and the impact of new construction, if that happens, on the school district. So I'd like to make a comment here about first the property values. We think here that the property values for these participants, these petitioners, is being suppressed. And it's being suppressed because the market is different than when these were subdivided. People bought bigger lots at that time. Today, they don't buy those lots. They still want their nice big house, but there's not a lot of value given for that larger home site. Less people have horses than in the past, things like that. So we think that if the petition is approved, that this will create an opportunity to create more home sites, therefore more homes that should add to the property values here in the community. New homes tend to be populated with younger folks, with families, with kids, and that could help reverse the trend that you're experiencing here in the community, which is a decline of school-age children in your school system. The second thing with traffic is, you know, we obviously have Oak Brook Road here, which handles a lot of traffic each day. Not all these lots face Oak Brook Road. Some of them here are on Canterbury Lane. We know that Canterbury has a different specification than Oak Brook, but it certainly is sufficient enough to take on any additional traffic that would occur from this. If you were to do a traffic study, the traffic study would probably say you have 10 or 11 cars a day coming out of one single house. That's because kids go to school or they go to soccer practice or what have you. These roads here are more than sufficient to take care of any kind of additional traffic load. And so we don't feel like there's any compromises here of public safety. With respect to any flooding concerns or environmental concerns, today we live in probably one of the most stringent environments in terms of engineering. The rules locally or DuPage County or even federally here are very, very tight. So what was maybe done in the past and maybe caused concern when other areas were replatted and developed, I think today you see a much better work product being produced and the technology is outstanding. So in the event that these property owners would exercise their option, remember, we're not asking for a plat approval, we're asking for the opportunity with a rezoning. If they want to ultimately subdivide their property and they'd have to go through the whole process of engineering and getting approval that way, I think you can rest assured here that this would not hurt the neighboring properties. Okay. And then the last thing about the schools is, and a lot of towns go through this, and that is, declining population. We've seen this time and again, and if you continue that direction, sometimes schools close just because they don't have enough enrollment. And so the way that we're looking at this is, in the event that a property is rezoned and new homes are built and families come in and they bring kids into the environment here, a $500,000 home would generate about $5,000 per year for the tax district. Okay, taking your current rates, and your school district gets about 75% of the tax bill. So you've been very generous to your school district, because some of the other communities that I've done business in are 2/3 or 60%. So you're almost at 75% for your school districts. So after all is said and done here on these four hot buttons, and I'm sure that the folks on the other side of the room have these, I think we can address their concerns about property values, about traffic, about environmental issues. And I don't think that the school is an issue, quite frankly, just because you're in a declining kind of enrollment, and this would only help the enrollment and the tax base going forward. So I'll leave it up to the chair here. Do you want to have our participants here come and say a few words now, or do you want to have the other side comment? How would you like to handle that?
Commissioners ask questions, and then have the other homeowners.
Mm-hmm. And then. Sure. So, just follow this procedure.
Okay. What we're going to do is follow the procedure of the Plan Commission as it is. You've made your presentation, and what we're going to do is ask the plan commissioners if they have any specific questions of you.
Okay.
And then all those in favor who want to speak will then follow through with making their appeal.
Okay.
Their presentation. Okay, can I open it up? I'm going to open it up to the plan commissioners. Dr. Lal, you had a question.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you for your presentation.
You're welcome.
As I've gone through, with all due humility, there are a lot of assumptions are made here, you touched on four factors, hopefully to back up your property value factor. Maybe you can provide us, the staff, the data in past 10 years, what has happened. Mm-hmm. So that is first thing.
Okay.
Schools, as far as we are concerned, the referendum in the village last year, they wanted to combine the both the schools. I don't know whether you're aware of or not.
I was.
And that failed.
Yeah.
With huge majority.
Sure.
Number three, this diagram which you pointed, the adjoining property is 3.5 to 3.8 acres.
Yes.
So initial owners who bought that property, they knew they're buying a bigger lot with some reason. And I think, maybe this is my sense, I can't, when Mr. Butler had a vision creating this village, he wanted these lots bigger, and especially close to the 294, if you look at it. You know, if you go in the Yorkwood, those lots are, as you pointed out earlier,
mm-hmm.
because with the idea the people will have a space, maybe some have wanted some horses because of his love of horses,
sure.
his stables, and all that stuff.
Yes.
So the question goes back to, if the homeowners in the beginning bought the lot with knowing what the zoning restrictions are,
mm-hmm.
and now coming back for the amendment for the map, you know, this is, you know, Oak Brook Village is a village is known for rural setting, the environment it provides, its elegance, this area, forest area everywhere, greenery, 240 acres are devoted to our park district, nobody can touch it. So with that idea, this is Oak Brook. This is the allure of Oak Brook. It's not about, you pointed out the homes there, but this area is very special.
Mm-hmm.
So that is other thing. But I would appreciate that there is, I have gone through this, if you be able to support the data, give us the data, that the typically raises property value of surrounding properties in your answer question B, the last paragraph.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing which really touched me, that G, where you said, a thriving community that welcomes a new home construction is more likely to be a place with higher moral values than community that is not longer thriving. So do you mean Oak Brook is not thriving?
No, by no means.
So the investment in a new home is the endorsement of the community who concerns itself with the general welfare of the public. I mean, that assertion is a little bit too much, I do think. Okay. On the other hand, you raise the issue about taxes and increase the revenues. But don't forget that once we have these small homes, who has to maintain the roads? Who has to provide the utilities? This is expense. And this is not an initial investment. I mean, expense. This is yearly expense,
mm-hmm.
which we have to sustain it.
Sure.
So, Madam Chair, I'll close my remark with that opening statement. And so I think we got to get some more information.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anybody else have any other?
I do have a question for you.
Ken, sure. Go ahead.
Of the 11 sites, 10 are improved, correct? There's only one that.
There's one vacant lot, Dr. Jafari's. That did have a home at one time that's been torn down, yes.
Of the 10 that are improved, are any currently vacant?
No. No.
So then whether it's rented or family, there are people that would be spending money in the community currently in those homes?
Yes. Yes.
All right. And then the road for the two properties, 105 and I believe it is, or 107 and 115 on Oak Brook Road, is that a private road? It's not on 31st proper. It's a road that goes down to the side.
Yes, it is.
It's a private road?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now those properties.
Excuse me.
Why don't you speak in the microphone?
Jen, microphone.
It's a private road, but when the tollway was put in, I believe in the late 50s, they were granted an easement to access the tollway. But the homeowners own the land.
And they're responsible for plowing it, whatever?
That's correct. And I might add, some years ago, by the way, I'm John Kiefer.
John.
Give me your address, too.
115 and 107. I've lived on 31st Street for 40 years, five of which was at 409, and then the remaining 35 at where we are now. 15 years ago, I bought 115. And the point I was going to make was when we moved in, the village took care of the plowing. As the years passed, and things have changed quite a bit in the village, but I won't get into that at the moment. We noticed traffic down the road, and mostly everybody is friendly. Well, as the years went on, people became a little less friendly. We had minor incidents, etc. So I put up a set of gates, and I put the sign private on there. Shortly thereafter, the village manager got a hold of me and said, basically, the plowing is not our responsibility. I can't find anything in the records. We're responsible. That was the end of it. So was it a gratis over since the late 50s up until, I don't have the exact date, let's say the 90s, or I'm sorry, 2000-ish? I can't say for sure, but there lies your little difference in the way the road is. Yes, we do own it. I'm responsible for my part. I plow it, take care of it, all that. The easement is the easement. So if that can help you in that question.
And it's the same on the north side for the 105 or the 110 property. That is also 110 and 116 are on a private road also?
You know, Beth, can you answer that?
Yeah.
Madam Chair, can I ask that every speaker use the microphone correctly? Because I can hardly hear them up here.
Okay. Can you please state your name, please?
Sure. My name is Elizabeth Bafardi. I live at 110 Oak Brook Road. Back in the day when we moved into that house, the driveway didn't curve such as it does now. It came straight up. When they built the toll road, that we had to have an easement come across 116's property in order to get out because we wouldn't have been able to make it up the hill. So that's been there for, I don't know, since late 50s? No, it has to have been there before because when we bought the house in 1971, I don't think it was there. I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but either way.
Does the village maintain that road or
no? That's all on us.
Okay. All right, the other question I had, Art, yep, is I'm sure you've contacted the other people that are involved, the other homeowners.
Yes.
And a concern for me is that there's such a low percentage of the involved people. You know, typically when you're going to change something, you're never going to get everybody to agree. But if you have a two-thirds majority, you can at least kind of reason that there's enough people that are speaking for this. I do take it that you have tried to get more people. It just hasn't happened.
Yeah, John has been the point person. I don't live or work here in Oak Brook, but John has contacted folks. We've met with them on a couple of occasions, and some folks are not interested in it. That's fine. Others, one in particular, had a much bigger plan to put in more lots on his couple of lots, and we weren't heading in that direction. We wanted to just go from R1 to R2. So, and since this has been made public, John has fielded a few more phone calls from a couple other people that may want to get on this petition as well. They're not here tonight, you know, but so it's what we have. It's what we have.
And the other concern that I have is, You know, I don't know that your argument that your property value is suppressed holds water. Number one, 321 Canterbury has the same requirements that you do, and they're building a brand new home there. So there is a market for it. Maybe it's a different outreach, maybe whatever. Sure. But the other problem is building smaller homes or similar size homes on smaller sites. They will be compared against each other, and you could actually lower the value of the existing and new construction that is on the 2-acre parcels. So that is a concern.
Yes. Yeah. Can I answer any of these, or how do you want me to?
If there's a question, yes, please do answer it.
If I can. You know, we all remember here about statistics classes that you got to flip the coin 100 times kind of a thing to get 50-50. You know, there's always a case where somebody sold a home here and another level there. I think we can safely say here that the days that these larger home sites are on the market tend to be longer than a smaller home site. Okay? So there's the adage of time is money or those kind of things. If you start breaking these things down into the price per square foot that somebody is paying for a smaller lot versus a larger lot, I think you'd also see that price per square foot is higher on those smaller lots. Okay? And that sort of stands to reason as well. And so all we're trying to do here is to give the opportunity and the right in zoning, if one of these property owners would like to add one house or two houses to their property. And one of the things I wanted to mention, if it'd be okay here, this is not a great resolution here, but, you know, as you go further to the north along the tollway, you see quite the density here, north of where's the button here? Did I get the right one? Oop, that's not the right button.
The top button is the pointer.
Ah, okay. So here's the subject property here. We call this the south parcel and then the north parcel in here. But you can see here all of this density is along the tollway. And so what we're asking for is not anything near this kind of density, although as I understand, your water and sewer systems could handle this, and engineering-wise it could be accomplished. But you have many of these houses here, wherever they're set on the lot, you can't, one of these houses here, Dr. Jafari has, the way it's situated, you couldn't get two more home sites on it because of the placement on it. So there is one comment in your, I think it's in the staff comments, that says, gee, you could maybe get 17 lots here or 15 lots here. That would probably only happen if everybody knocked down all the lots and formed a joint venture with their neighbors. So I don't want to scare people that there's that many. You're probably talking, 10 lots or something at the end of the day, if it were to happen, not 30 more home sites. So that's why I'm saying about traffic, and I'm looking at the practical side of these things. Okay?
We understand. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Simon, did you have any questions or comments?
No.
All right. Tom, you had something.
Yes. In terms of the petition, it seems to me that the lots that are north of 31st Street, I can see an individual petitioner requesting a subdividing of those lots on the basis of some kind of hardship. I cannot see those lots being included in this kind of a request, because you would truly be getting into spot zoning, as far as I can see, with those two lots.
Yeah.
It's an arbitrary request with no hardship presented, requesting that they be rezoned. The lots that are south of 31st, The lots that face on 31st Street, Oak Brook Road, I see an issue there because any kind of a subdivision of those lots is probably going to involve flag lots. Mm-hmm. Flag lots are not a happy thing with the Plan Commission. We have allowed them, and that's so it's, but I say they are not a happy thing.
Sure.
Now you're beginning to look at the potential of several additional driveways going on to 31st Street. If this were more comprehensive and you had an interior road, basically a frontage road feeding out onto 31st Street at Hunt Club Trail, from a safety point of view, that would make a lot of sense. But none of that is in this plan. The current plan is, so you're requesting us to change the zoning, and each time any of the petitioners who are involved in this, they're going to have to come in and request a change anyway. So the only thing that I can see that this petition is asking is that instead of each of the petitioners coming in individually, we're going to do it globally so that it avoids, quite honestly, the aggravation of coming before us individually. So, but I have, because there's nothing comprehensive about the request, except that we change the zoning, with no indication of what future plans would be, and you know we're boxing in those homeowners who choose not to be part of the petition. I find it very difficult to say that, you know, this is really, there's nothing comprehensive about it. I guess that's what I'm saying. There's
sure.
nothing comprehensive about it that allows us to see what the future might be. And, you know, let's put it this way. You'd have to do a lot more to convince me to vote for it.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
What I was going to suggest right here for the benefit of everybody else is to have our village attorney maybe help us with the definition of spot zoning and flag lots, just to make it clear to everyone
sure.
what that is.
Okay. Let me get to the right page. So, I'll break down my comments this way, is that you are presented tonight with 11 different parcels that have decided to join together in the process to go through starting here and then the ZBA hearing process, but they're really, you know, 11 separate applications. You are free to find that all the lots meet the requirements. You are free to find that some do and some do not. You can break it up in the way that you feel is appropriate based on whether or not it meets the factors. Now, in your procedures, as well as under the case law in Illinois, you are looking at, in terms of the zoning, rezoning these lots, are what's commonly referred to as the LaSalle factors. They are laid out, and I'm happy to go through them if anybody is not familiar with them, but, you know, in section 8.3 of your rules of procedure. And those are the factors which are different than subdivision issues, which is different than the issue of does it individually create a flag lot or not. Now, the flag lot is a colloquial term, usually refers to when you have a lot in which, you know, you don't want to create you can't really create an island lot that doesn't have street access. So you oftentimes, what a flag lot is, will have a driveway that goes from the front of one property to access a rear lot. So it looks like a flag. And you know, some of that is really will be dealt with at the subdivision level, and you can consider it to the extent that you find that it meets one of, you know, the factors that are listed, you know, in your procedures. So, now, the concept of spot zoning has been raised, and I want to be careful with the idea of spot zoning because, you know, to a lot of different people, it's a term that means many different things. But as I mentioned, you are really focusing on the factors that are set forth here in your in the procedures. Which one is not is this spot zoning? Now, you can have a lot that qualifies under the factors, even though it's one lot surrounded by others. And the Illinois courts have made clear that you could have a one-lot zoning district, depending on if it meets the factors. Now, you also might find that a single lot surrounded by other lots that differ in changing the zone does not meet the factors that are set forth, so which include the character of the neighborhood, the extent to which property values are diminished by the particular zoning restrictions, the extent that to which removal of the existing limitations would depreciate the value of other property areas, and so forth. So just because, I will say, just because there's one lot surrounded by other zoning uses, that does not mean that it is an illegal case of spot zoning, if such a thing exists. It's more of, do you find that, based on the application, that the factors are met? So I hope that answers the question. And if you have others, I'm happy to.
Well, don't the LaSalle principles also indicate a hardship, though? I find it hard to see anybody with a hardship here on either side of it.
Well, so the factor I believe you're referring to is it's referenced in Section 8.3G, the relative gain to the public as compared to the hardship imposed on the individual property owner, is the way that it's in your procedures.
Okay. So if I could just respond to Commissioner Doyle, and I think your village attorney kind of touched on that. We're at the stage here with talking about this zoning change. It's not a subdivision process. It's not architectural review or anything like that about what the house is going to look like. It's a step-by-step process. In a perfect world, somebody would come in with 10 houses in 10 different locations, and they're all going to look like this, and this is how they're going to access the street. That's not the case here. And again, it just gives the opportunity to these property owners to then, at a later date, if they so choose, to come in and say, gee, I'd like my son to be able to live on my property. Okay, I'd like my father to be able to live close to me, or some sort of thing like that. So that's the stage we're at. I see your point, Commissioner Doyle, completely, but this is just the steps that we have to take. And I think the flag lot or shared drive, because it doesn't necessarily have to look like a flag at the end of the day, it's really a shared drive. I think that's probably what you want at the end of the day, because you want to limit the amount of curb cuts that you would have, especially on Oak Brook Road. I mean, physically, you could probably, if you had three lots on one of the properties, you could have three curb cuts, but I don't think the village would want that. Or is Oak Brook Road the village's jurisdiction, Bob?
County Road.
County Road. But the county would still have some say-so in curb cuts, I would assume, right?
It's their jurisdiction.
Yeah. So nobody's proposing three curb cuts. You'd probably just want to limit it to one. And in a perfect world, if two of the property owners together could share that, so you'd have only one curb cut. But that's down the road. Right now, we're talking about being able to have that opportunity for these folks here to move forward. And if I could just double back to Dr. Lau, the questionnaire that the village has is quite comprehensive. And the one that I struggled with the most, the question, was the moral one. Okay, what is moral? So, what I was trying to express there is that towns that are vibrant, certainly like Oak Brook, continue to be vibrant because they reinvent themselves over time. And to your point earlier about Mr. Butler had a vision 40 or 50 years ago, whenever that was. Things evolve over time, and sometimes there's better ideas than there were 50 years ago. And so what we're trying to encourage here is the opportunity to take advantage of your great location that happens to be landlocked. You're bumping into all these other suburban communities and the tollway. So here's an opportunity to add more homes, hopefully a younger demographic, to the town, and presumably when that continues to thrive, it's just a better place to live. But I really had a tough time with that moral thing, so you caught me on that one, because I was struggling with that.
I thank you for your clarification, but as I said in my opening statement, there are a lot of assumptions were made.
Of course.
And there are a lot of rhetoric. If we knew about the future, we wouldn't be here today. You know? Yes. So I think...
Oh, wait a minute. Hawks win. No, I'm just kidding.
No, that's okay. We want that's maybe the reason we should get home sooner.
That's right.
Madam Chair, but...
That's right.
But leaving that aside, I think, you will do us a favor if you can get some data.
Sure.
Which you have alluded in your question and answers.
We can do that.
Because our staff would love to see it.
Sure.
And moreover, I like to be educated.
Okay.
Well, thank you.
Fair enough.
Okay. One question I have. Originally, there were 17 petitioners. Why did 6 of them back out?
We had a couple people sell their property. Kruger was one.
I
might add that particular property Art's talking about. They were in with our group. The new owner has kind of just got his feet on the ground, and I've spoke to him, and he's all for it. So he may be added here in the near future. Also, I can address your other question. The people that decided not to go were just two. We had Kruger was a property change. Then we had a little trouble in contacting the owner on Hunt Club and 31st. His name is...
We don't need to do the name. Just... That's okay. Just...
Okay.
Yep, the circumstance there. You can say the circumstance, but we don't need the names.
Okay, so the circumstance on Hunt Club and 31st, we contacted that owner just here in the past couple of weeks. He already signed an application, but it's a little too late to bring him to this point. So I won't dwell, because I think Art wants to say some more, but some of the questions that a couple of the other fellows had, I can address that, I think, pretty thorough, only because of the time frame between 1940, when these lots were initially sold, up till now. And I'll let Art speak.
So, and as I alluded to before, there was another potential petitioner, who listened and wanted to do a more aggressive rezoning, and we did not want to do that. So, we could reconcile all the other ones, but people have moved on, and like I say, our property was sold. So, and there may be other people that would come on board as well. But this is what we have right now, and I think it's a significant mass of people. I realize it's not 3/4 or anything like that, but this is something that people don't do every day, to be able to be here tonight and to be in front of people and say, I live here and I'd really like to make it a better place, and if I could get my dollars out of the property, and recognizing too that they're next door to some people that don't want this to happen. I think it speaks volumes here of people that have stepped up with what we do have here with the 9 different property owners. So I think there's a good enough critical mass here.
Okay. Simon,
I'm concerned with the bitty, itty bitty piece here, a piece there. I would much prefer to see a whole area being rezoned rather than lots that are picked out of people's opinions.
Sure. Well,
I don't feel comfortable with it.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
I don't feel comfortable with these bits.
Okay. You know, we're limited, if I might respond. We're limited here a little bit with scale. What you're looking at in these two communities, north and south of Oak Brook Road, it's about 40 acres of land. And when you take the petitioners and their aggregate, you have probably about 65 acres in total, and I think we've got about 40 acres accounted for here. So we're communicating this on a lot by lot basis, but when you take a look at it, there is a sizable critical mass here looking at these two neighborhoods. Like I'm saying, it's roughly about 40 acres that's being asked to change out of maybe about 65 acres in total, maybe 70 acres. So I think a little bit better than half.
Well, I would prefer to see a future plans for these lots, not just to rezone them, but what's going to happen after if they were rezoned. What would happen then?
Yeah.
We've had no indication of that.
And I think you're piggybacking on Commissioner Doyle's comment is to see what that looks like. And I guess I'm asking you as a group, and I realize that this may not be your recent experience. I've done a lot of zoning of farm property. I've probably zoned about 15,000 home sites over my career. And it is a common thing for people to say, well, what's it going to look like at the end of the day? Well, what happens is that you get the zoning first, and then you start spending money because you have the authority then, you know, to do something like to design a subdivision, design houses, and those kind of things. So, you know, if you ask us to be at a different standard than you would for a vacant parcel someplace, that doesn't seem to be fair, because that would be the process, and your village attorney is kind of touched base on that. It's steps. We want to get to first base here with the zoning. Second base would be if there is a subdivision. Third base would be somebody to review plans, and coming home would be to build that house. And so we're just trying to get to first base here. We're not, you know, coming around the whole thing. So that's what our purpose is tonight. And it's just not a practical thing to ask nine different property owners to do a subdivision design. And then the next question could be, well, let me see what those houses look like. It's just human nature. I want to see what's there at the end of the day. But we're just asking for you to follow the process that you would ordinarily follow if you just had a piece, you know, a 40-acre farm in the middle of town. I think the steps that we're taking are what you would do on that same kind of property.
I just want to quickly make one thing that I'm sort of piggybacking that on Tom and also Simon's comment,
sure.
Especially in terms of the cell factor number D, the suitability of the property for zone purposes. I'm having a hard time trying to understand what you're trying to do with that, and how suitable it would be without seeing any kind of plans. Whether it's something that you finally do or don't do, surely you've got to have some kind of idea. I'm an architect. I can't go to a client and say, I got an idea, I'm going to do this for you. They're going to say, show me.
Okay.
And I too would like to see, surely you have to have some idea how you can accomplish what you're doing, because it's more than one lot. Those are big chunks of property.
Sure.
And there's some disjointed property that's across the street that seems to have no relationship to the other properties. I would like to see what would be the benefit of it.
Okay.
How would it be suitable to rezone that?
How about if we could give you one example, just take a property and show you a sketch plan. so that you could get an idea. We don't have that prepared tonight. But, you know, we're not going to get a vote tonight here because everybody has to have a chance.
Like a cluster, for instance, because, you know, you do.
We can, I think we can show you. But remember, you have individual property owners. And as I was saying previously here, I don't anticipate everybody to go into some sort of joint venture and jointly develop these properties. But, you know, working with Dr. Jafari, I think we could put something together here to illustrate one property to just show you what it would look like, just so you'd have an idea. It would address ingress and egress and flag lots and all those kinds of things. And that way you can see one of them just as a, you know, as an example. And I think that would maybe give you some comfort. I hear you loud and clear, and I certainly understand. Everybody wants to know what it's going to look like at the, you know, at the end.
Because I'd like to see something tangible that gives me some kind of evidence.
Okay, that's a fair thing, and why don't you let us do that, and we'll put some dimensions on it and all that kind of stuff, and you can kind of see what that would be.
I think that would be helpful.
Okay, we can do that, sure.
Now, unless any of the plan commissioners have any questions or comment for Art, I'd like to listen to some of the other ones who have want to speak in terms of favorability.
Sure.
And then for each individual, I mean, the plan commissioners also have an opportunity to, if they feel like they have a question for that individual.
Okay, good. Okay. Who wants to be first?
I'll be first.
You want to be first? Okay. Go ahead.
Again, I mentioned to all who I am and how long we've lived here. I'd like to give a different perspective on what you see on the board here. If you could look at the whole piece from York Road to 294, 31st Street to Canterbury, that's a total of 80 acres. Don't look at the yellow part, just look at the whole block. In the old neighborhood, we all lived on blocks. From York Road, approximately 650 feet on one side, 660 on the other, going east, and approximately 1,390 feet across from Canterbury to 31st is 20 acres. The remaining going east is 60 for your total of 80. The 20 acres that starts in York Road that I explained the dimensions, that is R1 zoning and less. The complete block initially in 1940 was sold off. Where we are in these 60 acres, one fella owned, and he split them up into 3.8 acres, two of which were 3.2 because it just didn't come out in the arithmetic. What I think we need to look at, and I need to back up, there's no road splitting up this 80 acres. This is all one block. So in a matter of succession, the 20 acres, like I said, it was zoned R1 and less. We've had this 2-acre minimum, I'd say, for approximately 40 years or more. It was before I moved there. So what I'd like you to look at is that complete block. Our petition here is for several reasons. We've got a hardship on the surrounding area. If you look at the complete village, we are isolated because of our zoning compared to the rest of the village. I think you need to look at that also. And going back to the hardship, we have a certified appraisal that states that if these lots were zoned 1 acre, the land value would probably double. That's a fact. It's not a guess. It's, you know, so that's our hardship. We're finding a difficulty in selling these bigger pieces because, as I mentioned, generally, you know, what is it, 90% of the town is 1 acre or less, and we're held to the standard of a 2 acre. And quite frankly, in today's market, not prior, I'm going back some years, people don't want these big lots. And if we can produce a price comparison, you'll see, as a matter of fact, that people are buying 1 acre lots for X amount of dollars and just passing right by these 2 acres because nobody wants them. You know, why should they buy 2 acres when they can buy one? And granted, you know, everybody says they have a nice, beautiful home on these other lots. There's no doubt about it. They put up some nice size homes. And I think everyone can notice that when you drive up and down York Road. Anybody else would like to speak?
Hello, I am Dr. Jafari. I have lived, or have been living in Oak Brook for past 40 years, and I have many investment in Oak Brook, as some of you may know. And aside to these lots, I have some other properties. As I see on this block, 9 out of 16 are asking for this rezoning. And even though there are more than 2 acre lots, but still you may question when we break them to 2 acres, what it looks like and how we enter and egress. I should say that my lots, 313 Oak Brook Road and 314 Canterbury are back to back together. At the time I market them separately for sales, nobody bought them. A realtor suggested that we combine and make very nice presentation for somebody who buy both of them and have a horse and have separate home and made a nice design, and that was in the market for a long time, did not go for sales. So the hardship that are talking about is hardship to sell and liquidate some of the investment. Currently, our lot in Oak Brook Road is sharing a driveway with our next door neighbor. So potentially, even there are three homes using the same, it may not need more curb cut to get there. And also, on schematic way, I could combine the two lot and have just entrance or exit to Canterbury or to the other side. Again, that would be definitely presented to the board and get everybody's input. I do a lot of investment in land and property, as Art indicated. He's working on big parcels, and I firmly believe that any owner can make the best use of his lot or his investment and his land. If there is any question?
Thank you. Next.
Okay. Good evening, Chairwoman and the members of the Board Plan Commission and everybody. Thanks for giving me an opportunity. My name is Dr. Vibha Thacker, and I live at 104 Canterbury Lane. And I think my one of the biggest hardship that I had was I have only one son, and he came home every day from the school. There was nobody to play with him. We didn't have any neighbors close by, and we didn't have like neighbors with the kids. So he came home and did his homework, finished everything he was supposed to do. When does he go and play? So I think that was pretty hard for us. And the other thing I miss is not having neighbors close by. So, you know, I mean, the neighbors are so far apart. We didn't feel very close. I mean, we have wonderful neighbors, Mr. Roca and Mr. John Kiefer, but, you know, you don't see them, you don't talk to them. The closeness that you would have as a neighbor was just missing. And, you know, I know that if the house was there next door, maybe acre or, you know, even less land, and there is a house next door, I would have a neighbor to go talk to, or I would have a neighbor that I need in emergency that I miss. And definitely my son had nobody to play. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone speaking next?
Hi, my name is Elizabeth Bafardi. I live at 110 Oak Brook Road. First, I'd like to apologize for my casual dress. I didn't have any intention of changing, but my driveway is flooded and I drive a Mini Cooper, so I'm not making it through tonight. I have been a resident of Oak Brook for on and off for 43 years. I grew up here for 23 years and I lived in Chicago for 17, and now I'm back for the last three. When I was growing up, my mom always cut the grass and took care of the yard herself. Our yard is approximately 2.5 acres. And when we were kids, there was a family down the street in York Woods that made a small fortune cutting all the neighbors' grass. However, kids these days don't have the same kind of jobs that we had when we were kids. And our closest neighbor, they ended up being the closest neighbor with kids our age for the first 17 years that we lived in 110. So in essence, we grew up in an island of sorts, and as all the neighbors were much older than my parents and their kids were grown and usually out of the house, it would have been nice to have kids a little closer to our age and a little closer in distance, you know, just like the Thackers had said. I was told that one of the objections to the proposal of allowing us to subdivide our lots was that it would change the flavor of the neighborhood. To that, I have the following responses. One, my former neighbors moved in with four kids, and then they had a fifth, and it completely changed the dynamic of our microcosm, much to the benefit of us. Suddenly, there were babysitting opportunities, kids to play with, and my former neighbor was a master gardener, so I learned a ton of stuff from her. Also, when we were growing up, you know, everybody had nice houses and pretty yards, and now, especially on York Road, it's McMansion Central, that's totally changed the flavor of the community, in that there's all these McMansions on the flag lots with, you know, I think it looks ridiculous. Oak Brook also used to be a horse-friendly community where you could go through the woods and see all the horses. Back in the day, we took riding lessons from the farm that was off of Spring and Adams. Now I'm told that horses aren't allowed on Canterbury Lane, so they can't cross. They can't use the underpass to cross over to the forest preserve. I was also told that you wanted to know about the hardship that was the hardship that we endured for not being able to subdivide our lots. 3207 York Road, it's a little blue house that's for sale for $900,000. It's a three-bedroom, two-bathroom house with a two-car detached garage. To my knowledge, it hasn't been lived in for years. It's being sold as is, so basically it's a teardown. 116 Oak Brook Road is a four-bedroom with at least four bathrooms with an attached three-car garage. And it was originally listed for $1.295 million, and it sold for $1,060,000. It's a difference of $235,000, or 18%. The difference between the two houses alone is huge. One is beautiful and the other one's a teardown. The difference between the two lots is 1 acre. The difference, the price differential for the acreage is that the house on York Road, the little blue house, is $842,155 per acre. And the house next door to me sold for $489,127 per acre. The point that I'm making is that how can you have a house that's listed as a teardown command a price that is almost in line with a house that's in beautiful condition on a bigger lot? The answer is no one wants to take care of that big lot anymore. Most people moving to the area, except for me, are dual income families. They don't have time to keep up a large yard. Even if they have the interest in it, unless they're self-employed, there's no way their boss is letting them off to keep up with the grass's schedule. Also, if you hire a landscaper, it's a huge expense to cut 2 acres or more. As a point of reference, if I cut the grass myself, it's 4.5 to 5 hours. If I have somebody help me doing the hand cutting, it's 2.5 to 3 hours. I was told that one of the other objections to the rezoning was that it would create a donut hole in the properties. I disagree with this comment. To my knowledge, no one has actual plans to subdivide their property at this time. Everybody just wants the option. You know, I think the prices of the land and the houses would go up immensely if I could sell my house as 2 lots. I don't have any intention of doing this at the moment, but I think it would be a huge difference. I respectfully ask the commission to fully consider our request to subdivide. Again, to my knowledge, nobody has any plans to subdivide at the moment. We're just asking for the option. Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, I take exception to that. I believe one of the properties is listed on the market that can be either subdivided into 5 and 2 or 3 2-acre parcels. Currently, as we sit here today, I believe it's the Kiefer's property. There's a property listed.
Yes, that's correct.
That's right. So there is intention to subdivide it. There is intention. Let's not mix the words. There is an intention to subdivide these properties. And secondly, the property at 3207 isn't sold. It's just an active listing. So.
Right, but they had an offer for over $800,000 that they refused.
Right, it's still listed for $899. It hasn't sold. So the other one sold. This one's an active listing. But I just, you know, there is an intent. That's why everybody's here. Because you could get much more value for your property if you could subdivide it.
So exactly.
For the Kiefers, if they have 7 acres and they could divide it into 7 1-acre parcels, that could be a lot different than divided into 3 2-acre parcels. We understand that. But that is the intent of this whole thing, is to subdivide these properties.
Yeah, well, I think for some people, yes, I agree with that. I agree completely, but I think that it would be beneficial for all of us to have the option. I mean, right now, no, I have no intention of selling. I have no intention of moving. I have no intention of splitting up my property. But it would be nice that if somebody came to me and said, hey, I want to buy your property, but I want to put 2 houses on it, it would be great if that was allowed.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wants to speak for favorability? Can you please come down to the podium?
Well, there's that small one.
No, let's get it. This thing.
There's a copy of this. Mm-hmm.
It's right on your lips.
How do I zoom out?
It can't, doesn't zoom.
Oh, that's
it's
it.
It's just, it's stationary. But that's close to the entire village with all the zoning.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I think this might actually have a better picture for everyone to look at for the whole village. Just not that. And I'm sorry, I'm Nicole Kiefer at 107 and 115 Oak Brook Road. It does show that the R1 zoned properties are definitely not the majority. And I think as far as the hardship and the intention is that we want the ability to subdivide in order to sell and or split. I was previously in the mortgage industry for 15 years. And financing these days is very different than it was back then. It's very difficult when you get into the higher dollar amounts. So it's posing a problem, I think, from what I've seen over the years, that there's not as many people that are willing to go through all the hassle, number one. Number two, have all of the cash reserves because times have changed dramatically. And they do want the smaller lots. Nobody wants to spend the weekend cutting their grass for 5 hours and doing all the trimming. And if you farm that out to landscapers, it is a very large
chunk of monthly funds from your budget. I think we were talking about an appraisal that we had done recently for 115, and in the appraiser's comments, there, in the last year, there are were 13 lots for sale in the immediate area, and their market time was 221 days, so, which the normal market time is 3 to 6 months. So you can see it's really taking time, and people are taking a large hit when they do sell. You know, the 2-acre lots are selling for less or just as much as the 1-acre lots. I don't think it's about making money or changing the demographic. I think it's more of really getting what the land is really worth. Because we all know that land is worth more. It's just nobody, you can't do anything with it because they're 3.66 acres. So you have 2 acres, and then you have 1.66 that you don't have a use for if you're trying to sell it or build another home. And I guess I'm talking specifically about 115 and 107. And with regards to the flaglots on York, I'm not sure. I know that there was a question that it may turn into the same thing on Oak Brook Road, and I guess I'm not sure what that question is, because I think with the other, as far as 115 and 107, they're right next to each other, so it would be more of a, you would have your three separate driveways with access to that frontage road there. It wouldn't be, or I wouldn't assume it would be a flag lot entirely. And I guess I don't understand why we have all those, the flag lots on York, but we're not willing to look at it for everyone else behind them. And I guess that's Canterbury and 31st Street. And then you can see here that most of everything here. So this is the lot, or the, I guess the section we're talking about. And then your other R1s are here on the golf course. Then you have your little pieces over here, which are way down at the other end of 31st. And here, and this is back by Grand Mill. But as you can see, most of the others, I mean, you're going R2, R3. Because when the Butlers did, I know we talked about Mr. Butler when he came in. And yes, it was all farm country. Then they came in and they wanted to bring more families to the area. And that's how Ginger Creek got started. That's how York Woods got started. That was their intention. They wanted a community that they could put a school in with kids and families. So I guess we all feel like we're kind of the last part of the old Oak Brook, not necessarily the new and up and coming Oak Brook. I know my daughter attends Brook Forest, and I've talked to many parents that were in the market for homes. They want nothing to do with a 2-acre lot. We're all too busy now. I mean, the kids are gone all day. You're running around. It's just the times have changed from when I was little to now. And I think that everybody just wants the option to see if it's going to make a difference. Many of the people you're looking at here are going into retirement age. They can't take care of the lots anymore themselves, which they all have done over the last 40 years. Nor do they want to spend their retirement income on landscaping. So I think we're just looking for an opportunity to have the option and see if that can change the area and be able to move these properties more into the new families, with the young families, with the kids running around, going to the schools. I guess it's a little bit of a rough plan as of now, because nobody does have plans in the works. There has been an offer. No one has been drawing up anything. But again, to start drawing something up when you don't think you have that option is kind of a waste of time, I guess. So I think that's why we started here and just talking to you guys to see if you'd approve that.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else speaking for those in favorability? Yes, please come down to the podium and state your name and address. And then we'll hear from the opposing party.
Okay, I'm Nancy Carino, Berkshire Hathaway in Hinsdale. I'm sorry I'm not prepared because of the fact that I got stuck with the rain and traffic and accidents, and I'm not even dressed the way I wanted to dress, but I had some materials to bring with and I was not able to bring it. So I'm just basically going to just give you a little bit of information about the fact that I was a listing agent for 305 Oak Brook Road. And I had that property on the market myself for at least 2 years. It had been listed prior to my having it at a higher price, of course, and probably just at where the market started to take a change. Had several people interested in the property. It was a beautiful parcel of property, the 3.8 acres. The house took most of the property, and it had several additions on it. It was an unusual home, and it had an indoor pool. It actually was like a resort. And so I had a couple offers on it. The offers were a little bit lower because of the fact that people felt like maybe they might have to tear down the house or whatever, but you know, people did like the land. I ended up selling it. It closed in October. I had it listed for 2.249 and sold it for 2.2 to a family that he was from Ireland and felt like the property was like his home. However, he now is also interested in the possibility of subdividing if that's the case. But getting back to what they're all here for, I can understand. It's not so much that they want to knock down these homes or make subdivisions out of all this property, but they do want the opportunity to get the value out of the property in case something like that were to happen. Or they had a situation where maybe they needed to sell their property, and that is something that's more favorable for them. As far as the Butler and the old Oak Brook and everything, I can understand that, yes, this was like old Oak Brook at one time. But actually where Butler lived and all of his property is now considered old Oak Brook, and it's a subdivision. So they didn't take his property and keep it, make it sort of a what's the word I'm looking for? Shrine, nostalgia area. It is, old Oak Brook is a subdivision. So I think that what they're looking to do is not basically make subdivisions out of this, but just have the opportunity to go ahead and let some other families come in. Because of the fact, the families now are different. Years ago, I could see somebody would want that, their children, they'd have tennis courts, they'd have a pool. But now people go to country clubs, they go to Lifetime, that's their everyday. They don't want to be home, they work all day, they don't want to be home maintaining these homes and the property. They want to enjoy their families and they go other places. So that's just basically my opinion on the whole thing. And thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you. Okay, I think now we can hear from the opposition.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Fred Capetta. I presented to each of you this evening a letter of my authority filing an appearance on behalf of three particular property owners. And there are three or four additional property owners that contacted me as I walked in. The owners that I represent are 203 Oak Brook, 204 Canterbury, 200 Canterbury, Dr. and Mrs. Shabalia, Dr. and Mrs. Candido, and Nick Castaldo were the people that I represented that I filed an appearance for. Since that time, the residents of 409 Canterbury, 416 Canterbury, 401 Canterbury and 117 Oak Brook Road have indicated to me that they object. Some of them were here. Some of them are still here, I see behind me. I don't know that all of them are. And I don't specifically represent them, but I did mention that I was going to indicate that they were here and that they object to it. So let me tell you my thoughts on all of this. Zoning ordinances are designed to create permanent conditions throughout a city or a village to take care of the problems of the present as well as those of the future, and to the extent they can be reasonably anticipated. The purpose of statutory zoning authority is to ensure that adequate light, pure air, safety from fire and other damages may be secured, that the taxable value of land and buildings throughout the municipality may be conserved, that congestion in the public streets may be lessened or avoided, and that hazards to persons and damage to property resulting from the accumulation of runoff of storm or flood waters may be lessened or avoided, and that the public health, safety, comfort, morals, and welfare may otherwise be promoted and ensured, facilitate the preservation of sites, areas, and structures of historical, architectural, and aesthetic importance. To achieve these purposes, the municipal corporate authority has the power granted to it by the state statute of the state of Illinois to divide the municipality into districts of such number, shape, area, and have such different classes according to the use of land and buildings, height, bulk of buildings, intensity, use of lot area, area of open space, and other classifications as may be deemed best suited to carry out the purpose of the corporate authority. They also have the power to prohibit such uses or structures incompatible with the character of the district that they establish. A zoning ordinance should describe with certainty the area in which the particular restrictions are applicable. Zoning is done by districts and not by individual pieces of property. Zoning districts are created to permit stability, for without districts, one might build a house in one location, and the person next door to you will build a factory and work 24 hours a day, and you'll have lights and noise in your home. We can all appreciate what chaos that would follow. Order is necessary to establish the value of real estate. It is important that the uses are predictable. If the owner of the property has no assurance as to the stability of the zoning in his area, the value of the property will be detrimentally affected. To permit different uses of property, districts are generally abutted one to the other in the way that borders will not be abjectly horrible to each other. There is a place for a factory or manufacturing facility, but it should be more likely adjacent to a warehousing district, which could in turn border a commercial or business district, which in turn could border a multifamily district, which could border a single family district, and then less dense single family districts. The point is that simply allowing scattered use of property will promote chaos and cause property to be valued at its lowest price point. The State Zoning Act provides that corporate authority and municipalities which desire to exercise powers conferred by the Illinois Zoning Statute provide for a zoning commission with a duty to recommend the boundaries of districts and appropriate regulations to be enforced therein. Pursuant to these laws by which you are empowered to act, the fundamental building block of zonings are districts. Communities zone themselves to attract what they perceive as the most beneficial mix of uses. Oak Brook was initially designed with roughly one-third in open space, one-third in commercial, and one-third in residential. Oak Brook does not have a public transit system serving the broader community and does not have a downtown. Oak Brook intentionally and wisely organized itself around a regional shopping center and zoned land to attract corporate headquarters and surrounded it all by high-value residential real estate. That distinguishes Oak Brook from Naperville. They're different. They have different goals. They have different standards. Naperville is 40 miles away from a large metropolitan district, has less expensive land, is served by a regional train linking it directly to the Central Business District of Chicago. Naperville has recently acceded to developer desires for higher density to reduce the cost of land per unit of housing and provide more economical dwelling units for its city-bound working population. Each goal is proper and particular to itself. People settle in the River North area of Chicago in multifamily high-rise units because they want accessibility and facilities within the city, including public transportation to the Central Business District. People settle in Oak Brook because they want to settle in a residential community that is well-spaced and aesthetically pleasing, strategically located at the intersection of major interstate highways leading away in all four directions. People settle in the city of Chicago in the non-business district because they want a single-family or multi-family dwelling with reasonably available public transportation to the Central Business District. People settle in Barrington because they are willing to accept well and septic instead of city water and sewer, and have open residential land that might have some equestrian value within 40 miles of a major metropolitan community. The point is that different areas are developed for different purposes and to suit different needs and please different people. But whatever the reason or cause, when somebody comes to an area, once they invest in that community, they have a reasonable right and expectation that the zoning classes will be generally conformed to in order that their property values will not be negatively impacted by inconsistent adjacent uses. Zoning changes are not properly precipitated by simply the desire to achieve more money. Increasing the housing density permissible within a defined plot of land will, to a great extent, increase the specific value of that land, but not the value of the adjacent improved land. The adjacent land will decrease in value. If a person is willing to spend $150,000 on a plot to build a house, then the more plots of land to build a house that occur within a defined acreage will result in an increased value. Increasing individual value of specific land is not a proper goal of a zoning ordinance. Once the corporate authorities decide on their desire and their future vision for the land and use of facilities, a comprehensive plan is established and published. And it is the duty of the Plan Commission and the ZBA to guide the village to its proper execution. It is not the function of the committees of the village board to overturn or debase the adopted comprehensive plan or zoning ordinance. To help understand the comprehensive plan and its place in our community, I've asked Joe Abel to meet with us this evening. Now, Joe has been a land planner for 50 years. In particular, I asked Joe to compare your Oak Brook ordinance with the current petition. And I'm going to call upon him and ask him to point out to you where this petition violates your ordinance. And by the way, you made reference to the petition. I note that there was one petition filed for $2,100, not 12 petitions that should be treated separately. So as I see it and as I reviewed the documents, we're looking at a single petition of all of these things together as a single composite. Although this is not a hearing, I expect that I may, at the conclusion of Joe's discussion, ask him a few questions to focus on certain issues that I might have interest in. And certainly he'll be available to your questions for further discussion. But I believe his insight in this matter will be helping at arriving at a meritorious conclusion. So I'd like to call on Joe Abel, if he would, to either come down here or go up to the podium, wherever you'd like, Joe.
Good evening. My name is Joseph Abel, A-B-E-L. I'm a planning, zoning, and economic development consultant. My office is at 200 Forest Avenue, Glen Ellyn, Illinois. And as was stated, I've been doing this for a little over 50 years. I'm very familiar with Oak Brook. I had the opportunity when I graduated from the University of Illinois with a degree in city and regional planning and architecture to work for the firm of Carl Gardner and Associates. Carl Gardner was the city planner for the city of Oak Brook, or for the village of Oak Brook. I worked on many projects as a junior planner in this town. I did the layout for Ginger Creek, but our firm designed the entire plan for Oak Brook for Mr. Butler. So I gotten in on the ground floor, so to speak, in how Oak Brook was designed to develop. I have to say it's done a very good job over the years of maintaining the original concept that Mr. Butler had for Oak Brook. After I left Carl Gardner and Associates, I actually was hired to be the director of planning for first director of planning for DuPage County. I was head of the planning department for 17 years, worked very closely with the village of Oak Brook since the comprehensive plan that we developed for the county included all the municipalities. So every municipality had to sign off on the comprehensive plan we prepared. It took 7.5 years to get to all 35 municipalities, and Oak Brook was one of them. Through those 17 years, I worked very closely with Mr. Butler. He not only was the one who hired our firm, but he was also on my regional planning commission for the county. So I worked very closely with him for almost 25 years until his death. So when I hear this concept about old Oak Brook versus new Oak Brook, I mean, there was a concept for Oak Brook that it should be primarily, in addition to the commercial, we were actually able to move the expressway around to accommodate our design. There were a lot of accomplishments here. But the most important thing is that Paul's vision was that it should be primarily a single-family, low-density residential area, and it should include all sizes of multiple or of single family. You'll note, except for the development at the north end of town, it was an annexation, and some units that are attached, the rest of the municipality is totally single family residential. And his theory was that there should be a range of lot sizes, but his first lot size was the R1. And that's why there are a number of areas set aside for R1. He recognized, and the plan recognizes, your comprehensive plan, that yes, the predominant amount of land will be for lots that are in the R2 and R3. But he felt that there should be a range of lot sizes, and that's why, shown on the map, there are three or four R1 areas. It disturbs me when I hear people say that there's no longer a market for large lots. I do a lot of work up in Lake County also. If what I heard in testimony here is true, then Barrington Hills and Lake Barrington and those places will soon be ghost towns. We know that's not going to happen. There is still a tremendous market. The unfortunate thing in DuPage County is that we don't have a lot of R1 areas left. Most communities, such as Naperville, I tried, don't want to pick on Naperville since your planner came from there, and he had nothing to do with this, it was previous planners. I fought to keep as many of the large lot areas as possible in the southern portion of Naperville. But Naperville, because it has the rapid trains to the city and they wanted to be a big city, they didn't want to be a small town, decided to get rid of it. So Oak Brook is in a unique position of having one of the few areas that have sustainable R1 zoning classifications. Now, I can see where if you get an area that gets close to 3.8 acres, there are ways of maybe adjusting some lots through a variation process or something of that nature. But to wholesale, just take these lots and rezone them, and I know I don't like the term spot zone, but that's really what's happening here. Arbitrarily taking the lots that the people who bought here, their eyes were wide open when they bought these lots. If they wanted to be in an area where they could sit on the front porch and talk to their neighbors, then they should probably buy a house in Carroll Stream or something. There are places in DuPage County where they have this new town concepts where people can, the houses are closer to the sidewalk, they have porches. It's a movement that started about 10 years ago. But that's a movement for certain types of people. The concept that you're looking at here is one that I have never, I unfortunately take exception with the gentleman here who highly praised me, but I have, in my 50 years, have never used this approach of just saying, you know, give me a chance that maybe I'll develop my property and maybe I won't. That doesn't give the people that bought there with their eyes open and want to be there, and there are a number of them, because that's why this is not an area where the majority have come in and wholesale said, let's redevelop this area. There are many, and you'll hear from them after me, that like the area just the way it is. I think the most important word that came out of this whole thing is predictable. I have developed many, many zoning ordinances. I actually did the entire comprehensive rezoning of all of DuPage County. It was under my control. And so designing districts and where district boundary lines are supposed to be is something that I sort of have determined through the years is a science. And it's also an art. And there are concepts. And one of them is that you should try and make an area as large as possible. And you don't disturb it by introducing little spots here and there. I can't imagine. I do a lot of subdivision design. I really don't know. I took a got an aerial photograph of this area and marked on there where the existing homes are. And if you start coming in here with, first of all, I'm not in favor of flag lots. I think they're an abuse of good land planning principles. If you're going to come in here and redesign some of these areas down to 1 acre, you are going to dramatically change this area. And there is no way that the people who are living there now and do prefer the lifestyle that they have. I mean, this is a bona fide R1 zoning classification, just like the others throughout the village. And what you're coming down to is a density determination. When you're dealing with density, there's the concept of physical density. It's perception. And that's why I mentioned this thing about predictable. People want a predictable physical density perception for the area they live in. And right now they know exactly what they have. But once somebody says, well, someday in the future there may be five homes, are they going to be in front of my house? Are they going to be in back of my house? Are they going to be next to my house? In the county, there's in many municipalities. In fact, I was just working on a project in Glen Ellen where we are stymied because one person put their house up a little bit closer to the street some years ago. That their ordinance determines that that sets the setback for the rest of the world when they want to put extensions. And so we have to go for a major variation just because one house wound up being a little bit in front of the lot that we're working on. And so the same thing could happen here. You have a house, you have nice open areas around it, and all of a sudden you wake up one day and there's going to be three or four houses and they're going to be all around you, some of them in front, obscuring your views. And views in this area are very important. You know, I hear a lot about too much grass to cut and all of that. We do a lot of landscape work in our firm. I would assume that when you have lots this big, one of the things you might want to consider is natural landscaping. And when you look at your photograph, there's a lot of trees in this area too. So we're not talking about 60 acres of lawn. I set a goal of, we've been in our house in Glen Ellen since 1970 when I took the job with DuPage County. And I set a goal of that, and I've been there ever since 70. Every year, I eliminate 1 foot times the length of my property of grass through natural plantings. And it's worked out very well. I'm down to the point where I do very little things. But again, people who buy into an estate area should be able to afford a landscaper. And if you can't afford a landscaper, then yes, buy a house at a smaller lot and things of that nature. So everybody has to determine themselves, you know, what they want. But from a physical density standpoint, the number of people in the area, the number of dwelling units, the placement of the units, the proportion of the site that's built upon, traffic patterns and volume, privacy and perceptions, all have to do with this density question. And they will all be up in the air if you arbitrarily zone these lots in the middle of what is now a complete zoning district. As I said, I've designed many, many zoning district maps, and I try to keep the district lines as readable and understandable and predictable as possible. This one is interesting in that we are before the Plan Commission. We're not before the Zoning Board of Appeals, and that's why I didn't prepare. I talked to our attorney about looking into LaSalle factors, but we're not talking about LaSalle factors really today. Right. We're talking about the comprehensive plan. What is the, you know, what do we want in this particular area? What did this village want over the years? Comprehensive plan hasn't changed. This area has been zoned R1 for quite some time.
It's because it's in what is called Planning District Number 3, which is the Fullersburg Forest Preserve District. It takes its character. If you look at the big map, you'll see that there's a character that this property falls into. You've got the Fullersburg, you've got the polo fields, you got all kinds of things down in this particular area. It's one of the reasons that there was an R1 designation put in this area, along with two or three other spots throughout the village. I prepare a lot of comprehensive plans, and I can tell you yours is unique in that most comprehensive plans put in residential and just label it residential and leave it generalized and then rely on the zoning ordinance to specifically come up with a district. In your comprehensive plan, you actually not only show the color designation of residential, you do recommend densities. And this particular property and the property on both sides of the road are shown on your comprehensive plan specifically as R1, single family. And so, as a planner, I, number one, always rely on the comprehensive plan to start with, and then I go back into the zoning. And when you look at the purpose and intent of the zoning, Fred hit on a lot of it. But again, for a person that is already living in that area, it's important for them to understand that the intent of the ordinance is adopted to the end that value of land and structures throughout the village may be conserved. This area where people have made an investment, where they should be, it should be predictable, shouldn't have to worry about being surrounded by two or three other structures sometime in the future without any due process. The area would already be zoned, so it would go only through a subdivision review process, not a notification process where they'll know what's going on. They're going to wake up one morning and find some foundations being put in. When we're not talking about multiple family or townhouses, but we are still talking about bringing in a number of homes into an area that's been set aside for estates. So there is going to be some congestion associated with it. The ordinance also says you regulate and limit the intensity of the use of lot areas. That's what we're talking about, the intensity of the use of these lots. They're going to explode, and we don't know how. Again, the ordinance allows to divide the entire village into districts of such number, shape, area, and of such different classes. Got four different classes in Oak Brook that are compatible with the character of each district. I thought it was interesting. I always have a problem when I am developing a new ordinance with a community of taking them through the process of amortization. How do you get rid of non-conforming uses? And the ordinances provide for the gradual elimination of structures and uses which are incompatible with the character of the district in which they are located. We're not only going to get rid, we're going just the opposite. We're putting incompatible uses that are incompatible with the character of the existing area into this district. And your ordinance says you actually should be doing just the opposite. I could go on and on. I didn't want to give you a lesson in zoning and planning. I have a tendency to do that. I do some teaching assignments. But it is important for plan commissions every once in a while to just sit back and not just think about a particular proposal. Think about the big picture. The big picture is that there are good established R1 zoning classifications in this town. They were planned that way. They show on your comprehensive plan. And I don't think they should be arbitrarily decimated. And I think one of the most important things to come out of this is you've got to worry about setting a precedent. You start doing this kind of haphazard, and I call this haphazard, piecemeal, not knowing what's going to happen in the future type of zoning, and you're going to have people coming in and doing this in the other R1 districts and maybe in some of the R2 districts. They're going to come in and say, oh, we don't want to maintain 1 acre anymore. You know, maybe quarter acre is what we should be doing, like communities around us or something like that. So your actions today are going to set a precedent for other areas. And as I said, it's nice to have flexibility for the individuals that want it, but it's not predictable for the people that are there and want to stay. And again, I've been doing this for 50 years. I have never seen this approach used where you're just given a blank check to those property owners to come back later and go through a process that is not going to have a lot of public input. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Capetta, do you want to...
I want to make a concluding remark, sir.
Thank you.
I'm sure we're getting close to your time limit. I'd like to call your attention to the map. I gave you each a copy of the map, but we put it up on the board because I can see it up there. And at every request that you rezone 11 lots in a 39-lot R1 district, the 11 lots are cross-hatched there in red, and that district is your whole district there. So you get to see the whole district that you're talking. If these 11 lots allow for 11 units, but if you were to permit what's cross-hatched here, the number of units where there are 11 now would become 30, could be potentially become 31 units in the same area. I point this out to you so you appreciate that you would be creating islands of R2 zoning in the middle of an R1 district, which is not in accord with your ordinance or your comprehensive plan. You would essentially be condemning this R1 district to ultimate extinction, and you would be signaling that Oak Brook has changed its vision, and other R1 districts upon which Oak Brook was founded may not be sacrosanct. Your violation of the zoning district is unhealthy, wrong, and in contravention of your zoning ordinance and comprehensive plan. I've provided and have filed this evening with you a written response of the statutory.
Nobody heard me?
We did.
Okay. I've provided and have filed this evening a written response to the statutory factors required by your ordinance, and I think that the petitioner has failed to state a prima facie case in his factor presentation. Out of respect for your time, I will, in this time in my oral presentation, only briefly comment on two of the factors that I think were missed entirely. And that's factor E under your ordinance. That's how you label them. It says the length of time under the existing zoning that the property has remained unimproved. The answer is zero. These are all improved lots. That's not what this was intended for. These were all improved lots. Only one is not improved, and that's because the family tore that house down several years ago. The right answer to the question is all of the remaining all of the petitioning parcels are improved, except for one. Eight of the parcels have been improved for 45 years. One parcel has been improved for 21 years. One parcel has been improved for 11 years. The current R1 zoning has not prevented or hindered the parcels from being improved. They just want to cut off the back of the lot to get another lot out of it. And I want to point out the factor I. It says the community need for the use proposed by the proposed owner. The petitioner's response is non-responsive to that particular factor. But the community does not need more R2 zoning. The village currently has a very well thought out mix of R1, R2, R3 zoning. To change the zoning of a few parcels contained within an existing R1 district to create a few more R2 parcels is not something which is needed by this community. Madam Chairwoman, Commission members, I ask that you politely but firmly enforce the comprehensive plan and recommend this misguided petition. I believe the petitioner's efforts have gone awry, and they're making requests of the wrong community. Their effort to increase their individual property values at the expense of their neighbors in the village is inappropriate and ill-advised.
Thank you. Art, would you like to make a summary statement or rebuttal?
Well, I appreciate the comments from the other side. I'll work on my vocabulary to use some more powerful words like explode and condemn. I don't think we have that kind of situation here. We'll do some homework as requested. One of the commissioners asked for some facts here about property values. You would ask, Madam Commissioner, about an example. And we haven't seen the rebuttal until tonight in writing, so we'd like to respond to that. The one thing I do feel very uncomfortable about is the comment about turning 11 lots into 31 lots. Again, as I said at the outset here, these folks who I've been working with don't seem to have the inclination of knocking down their house and subdividing it to become the maximum yield of lots. They'd like to supplement, if they can, around the existing structures. And so, you know, I get the feeling here that the takeaway will be, or the headline is 11 equals 31, and we don't see that. That's not what we're about here. We're talking about the opportunity. If somebody wants to have a family member live close by, or have some neighbors, or have less work on a yard or some sort of thing like that, we certainly respect comprehensive plans and understand those. But you know, I think as John Kiefer was pointing out, is when this 80 acres started out as a farm, you know, and remember all the farms were those multiples of 80 acres and those kind of things. And this is obviously before my time on the scene. You know, it looks like here these lots just turned out fine, and I presume they're nice homes in here, and people are good citizens in here. And I think the property owners that are adjacent to it can look over to their side and say, well, gee, could I add one more lot here and just make it a better place? And again, with the village, you know, as villages age, they need to reinvent themselves, and there will be redevelopment opportunities, if not this parcel, some other parcel. So we won't be the only people knocking on the door of the village and having a conversation about what's new, a new trend, or a desire to have less work around the household. So we'd like the opportunity to come back to this board, answer our opponents, answer the questions that have been raised by the commissioners, and we really appreciate the time tonight. So that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Lowell?
Mr. Zapata, clarify for me, all your statement you have, is this all in this packet?
No, the oral presentation was all oral, but I can give you a written copy of what I said.
Yes, I think you were reading it from, am I correct?
I prepared it all in advance. I know
so
exactly.
Could you submit it to the staff?
I will, certainly. I'll give you a copy of the oral presentation.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. At this juncture, then, I would like to further summarize and say that this case is due for further discussion, and as the petitioner said, he has a little more data collecting and a possible proposal of an example of how they want to subdivide the property, and that will take place at next month's meeting. And unless somebody else has any objective, I'd like to say that we're going to continue this case for next month. Do we have to vote on this?
Yes. Okay,
may I have a motion to
continue?
Motion
to continue.
And a second?
Second.
Now, could we just, do we have to do a voice vote?
Voice vote.
I'm sorry? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And I assume there's no nay?
No.
No. Okay, we have, the ayes have it. The case will be presented at next month's meeting.
Which will be on July 20th, 7 o'clock.
We're just giving it a chance. We know what we're doing.
and Bob, and just thank you everyone for coming, and we look forward to talking to you next month. And at this juncture, we'd like to review other businesses.
Well, we need to go back.
Kind of skipped over the motion to continue.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So on the promenade, we were requested to continue that matter. You need to actually vote.
Oh, okay.
So it would be to continue the matter until such time as the applicant is prepared to continue the review.
Yes,
so.
Getting back to old business, we need to make a motion to continue on the promenade until the applicant is prepared to continue for further review.
So move, Mayor.
I'll second it.
Good.
Okay, I need that back.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Don't forget Simon.
No nays. Thank you. All right, and Bob, do you want to comment on other businesses coming up?
I just want everybody in the audience to know there's two things. The water's probably up about a foot from it was when you came. And the Blackhawks are winning.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for that information. Which is second period, or what is going on?
About 20 seconds to the end of the second period.
Okay, so end of the second.
31st Broadway is closed east of the Midwest Club entrance. West of the Midwest Club entrance.
Well, we need some insurance. Okay.
At this juncture, I'd like to motion for adjournment.
Before you adjourn, is there any other public comment?
Oh, I'm sorry. If you asked if there's
any other general public comment.
Yeah, is there any other general public comment?
No, thank you. The two names that I mentioned.
All right. Okay. One last thing. I'd like to have a motion to adjourn.
I'll make that motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Who motioned?
Did you make a motion to adjourn?
Yes, motion to adjourn. Second. Wait, meeting. Okay.
Bob, we can hold that off if you had something, Bob.
There was a motion and a second.
Yeah, okay. We have a motion and a second.
Lull and Wilsick?
I seconded.
Yes.
Fred wants to add this to our pile.
Thank you.
I need to do the vote.
Yes, I would like that very much.
I'll give you that.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for your comment.
It's formality, but yeah. All in favor say aye.
All in favor say aye. All in favor say aye to adjourn.
Aye, aye.
Thank you.
Okay. We're legal. Time to.